Good morning, children. Good morning, one and all. Welcome to DCEB Khammam and Suryapet YouTube channel. This is Krishna Priya, PGT Economics, TS Model School and Junior College, Anajipuram Village, Penpahad Mandal, Suryapet District. So, students, in the earlier class, we have been discussed about 9th class social studies second lesson, the natural realms of the earth. In that lesson, we come through the topics, the sea floor spreading, slow and sudden movements of the earth, and also the external process of the earth. So, continuing the lesson, I'm going to finish this lesson with the topics work of water, waves, winds, glaciers, etc., and also action of vegetation and human beings. Before that, I want to share my screen. So, students, in this lesson, we are going to achieve the learning objectives. So, the first four objectives have been achieved in the earlier classes. Mainly, the students are able to explain the four different realms of the earth, and also they can describe about the jigsaw puzzle and the moving plates. They can also explain about the sudden and slow movements on lithosphere. And also they can describe about the external process of lithosphere. So particularly in today's class, we are going to achieve the learning objectives. Mainly the students interpret how air and water transform the surface of the earth. Students explain the work of water, waves, wind, glaciers on the lithosphere. Students describe the action of vegetation and human beings on earth. So as I said, in the earlier class, we have been discussed about the denudation process known as weathering, erosion, transportation and deposition. So continuing the topic, we are going to know how the air and water changes the surface of the earth. So coming to the first agent, water. On the earth's surface, we have been seeing the first order landform and also the second order landform. There is another landform called third order landform, which is extremely changed by or created by the wind and water. So let us have a look how water changes the land surface. So as you know, children, the flowing water in streams and rivers across the land in sheets is the erosional process in shaping Earth's landscape. Streams and rivers are able to create both erosional landforms such as own channel, canyons, valleys, etc., and depositional landforms like floodplains, alluvial soils, deltas, etc., as they flow over Earth's surface. So the water creates many landforms on the Earth's surface. One of them is V-shaped valleys. V-shaped valleys. So children, have you ever seen the V-shaped valleys in the mountain regions like Himalayas? Yes? Yes. These V-shaped valleys were mainly created by the water. The V-shaped valleys are created by water. River flows down from its source in the mountains, and as it descends the slope, it flows with great force and cuts the mountain vertically, thus creating a V-shaped valley. The V-shaped valleys are generally narrow at the bottom and wide at the top. So have you ever seen a waterfall? How it looks like? The water is draining with a great force from topmost of the mountain towards the Earth's surface. So here the rivers, the major rivers in India or in the world, were originating from the mountains. So when these rivers are flowing towards the Earth's surface from the mountain, it is cutting the mountains vertically. The water cuts the mountain vertically. So here you can see the water is cut at this mountain vertically, where you can notice the V shape. So this V shape is narrow at the bottom. It is very narrow at the bottom and so much wider at the top. So the first formation created by the water is V shape. In order to join other landform by water is gorge. So other landform made by the water is gorge. So these are the some images. You can see how a gorge looks like. So this is the Indus Gorge, and this is one of the famous gorge, Jhansker Gorge in Kashmir. These two are located in Kashmir, and Bison Gorge in Andhra Pradesh. So what do you mean by gorge? How it is made up of and how it looks like? When river cuts the harder rocks, a very narrow valley with steep sides are formed. These are called as gorge. Example, Jhansker Gorge, Indus Gorge and Bison Gorge. So how gorge is created? Same as the valley. The river is cutting the harder rocks. What type of rocks? Harder rocks with steep sides. With a steep sides. See, this is the steep sides. So these are called the gorge. So the width and the sidewalls and the top of the gorge will be the same. The height, width and of course length will be same. So whereas valleys, they are narrow at the bottom and wider at the top. whereas gorges are in the same at the narrow and at the top also. Narrow at the they are wide at the bottom, and at the same time they are that much wide at the top also. That's why gorges are suitable for construction of dams. So how the gorges are useful to us? They are suitable to construction the dams. Can you think of the reasons for this? Why always dams are constructed on gorges itself? Why not on valleys, and why not on cairns? Yes, children, because here, as I said, the gorge bottom and the top and the side walls also the same size. The width, length are the same, where the flow of water will be steady. The flow of water is steady and constantly. So at that place, the construction of dam is very suitable, where the water can be reserved. Yes, children, that's why major dams were constructed on gorges. So other type of landform created by water is canyon. So this is the canyon. So canyon and gorges look like similar, but they are vary in slight changes. They vary with very slight changes. So let us have a look about a canyon. A canyon is characterized by steep side of slope and may be as deep as its top as well as its bottom. In contrast, a canyon is wider at its top than at the bottom. Yes, children, have you noticed? So it is characterized by steep sides of slope. It just like a gorge. But whereas the bottom of the canyon is little bit narrower than the gorge and wider at the top. Okay, children? So in gorge, the bottom and top will be the same, and whereas in canyon, the bottom is little bit narrower than the gorge. So in canyon, a canyon is wider at its top than at the bottom. So here, the biggest canyon in the world is one of on the river Colorado. The Grand Canyon is 466 kilometers and width is 188 meters to 29 kilometers. So this one, you can see the famous gorge, which is located in USA, which is on the river Colorado. Yes, children. So this is the famous canyon in the world, which is located in the USA. So it is about 466 kilometers. So the length of the canyon is 466 kilometers. And what is the width of this canyon? It is about 188 meters to 29 kilometers. So other the landform created by water is a plung pool. So water is created V-shaped valleys, it created gorges, it created canyon, it is also creating a plung pool. What, children? A plung pool. What do you mean by plung pool? Have you seen any waterfall? Yes, children, have you seen any waterfall? So at the bottom of the waterfall, you can see a pool-like surface where some of the water is stored and flowing towards the other region. This type of pool is known as plunge pool. For example, children, if you pour a glass of water like this from the topmost height to the surface of the earth, what you can notice? When the water you poured with glass like this, the force of the water reaches the earth by digging up the soil. There you can notice a small round form of the earth surface. So the water is digging up the earth surface, where you can notice a pool that is called a plunge pool. Yes, children? So the best example, you can create your own plunge pool in your houses by pouring water with glasses or any other containers. So the waterfalls are numerous in the mountain areas where changes of slope are more abrupt. The waterfalls with great force and digs out the rock beneath to form a plunge pool. So here are the some famous plunge pools in the world. The highest waterfalls in the world. The highest waterfall in the world is Angel Falls on the river Churan, which is located in Venezuela. Its height is about 979 meters. So this is the first image you can see. It is the Angel Waterfall, which is located in Venezuela. What is the height of this waterfall? It is 979 meters. The second highest waterfall in the world is Tugela Falls on the river Tugela in South Africa. Its height is about 947 meters. So the highest waterfall in India is Kunchikal Fall on river Varahi. Kunchikal waterfall on the river Varahi in Karnataka state. Its height is about 455 meters. Okay, children. So the water has created V-shaped valleys, gorges, canyons, plunge pool, and also it is forming the plain areas, flooded plain areas, where you can see on the beds of any river. Whether you see the northern rivers or whether you see the southernmost rivers, there is a plain area created by rivers. So how this plain region has been created by rivers? Just have a look. So the best example to know how the plains are created by the rivers, with the best example, very lively example, a recent natural calamity that has been taken place in the Telangana and Andhra region. So one of the famous place everybody knows, that is Hyderabad. So in Hyderabad recently the floods has came. So this image show can be seen as before flood. So this area looks very pleasant, right, children? With peace and pleasant. When the flood comes, it looks like this. The water is floating on the streets of one of the place in Hyderabad. When the flood is finished, it deposited all the mud and the vehicles and other particles with it, which is deposited in some other places. Yes, children? Like in the same way, when a river is flooded, it carries so much of sediments, soil, sand, etc. with it, which is used to force to pour on the beds of the river, and the flood is finished, it deposits all the silt which it is carrying through, that means in times of flood, it is deposited on the beds of the river. When this floods occurs repeatedly, the beds is accumulated with the particles carried by the rivers. So whatever the plain regions created by the rivers, like Ganga, Brahmaputra, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, etc. See, these are the plains created by these rivers in times of flood. So the flood plains like Ganga and Krishna Godavari plains are formed due to the movement of the rivers. The speed of the river gets reduced when it enters a plain, and thus it does not have the force to carry heavy particles and hence deposits them on the banks. The rivers during the floods cut down the soil and produces silt, whereas the rivers without floods deposits silts. With the repetition of this process, the height of the riverbed increases with deposition, and when flood water comes again, it changes its course and cuts a new path. As a result, the river constantly changes its course into the floodplain to form meanders, turns like a snake, and later Oxbow Lake. And Oxbow Lake is a U-shaped body of water that forms when a wide meander from the main stem of a river is cut off, creating freestanding body of water. So this is the river stream, started on the mountains and end up with merging of sea or ocean. So whatever the landforms has been created on the surface of the earth is due to because of the river channel floating on the earth's surface. So earlier it is created V-shaped valleys, then gorges, then cayons, then canyons, and also plung pools, and also the meanders. What do you mean by meanders? It is just like a river floating in a snake shape. So how these meanders formed? So these meanders, how it is taking the snake shape? Because with the first flood, the river is carrying particles like sediments, rocks, soil, etc., which is deposited at one place. After second flood, again it deposits the particles which it carried through flood. Likewise, it deposits all the particles at one place. When that place is becomes height, the place where it is deposit all the silt is accumulated, and the river cannot flow further out of that place. So at that place, this river took a other direction. So it took a new path. So once this was coming like this, and it is deposited some fed here. So it is not in a position to flow out of that place, and again it divert itself to other channel to flow. So likewise, this meanders has been created. And how an oxbow lake is created? During the times of flood, some silt has been deposited in this place, and in the same way, some of the silt is deposited here also. Then this lake becomes isolated, which is look like Oxbow Lake, which is, it is called as Oxbow Lake. Always it will be in a U shape. Okay, children. So coming to the last landform created by the water is about deltas. So have you seen this channel of the river? Mainly it is originating from mountains, creating a V-shaped valleys, then a plung pool, then a gorge, then a canyon, later meanders, and also the Oxbow Lakes, and lastly it is going to create deltas, because it is the end point of a river to merge with ocean or sea. So the river is merging with the sea or the ocean, where you can see a landform as deltas. So when a river reaches the sea, the fine material which has not yet dropped is deposited at its mouth, forming a delta. The word delta is originated from the Greek alphabet delta. So it's just like a mathematical symbol delta. That is why it is called as delta. So this delta is the landmass created by the river with fine material which is not yet deposited earlier. It is depositing here when it is merging with the sea or the ocean. So one of the largest or greatest deltas in the world is Sundarbans, which is mainly formed by river Ganga, Brahmaputra, and also Meghna. So the three rivers, the three major rivers formed these deltas, which are world's famous deltas. Okay, children. So this is the work of water. So the water has created the landforms. What are the landforms? The water has been created. It created V-shaped valleys, gorges, canyons, plung pool, meanders, Oxbow Lake, and finally the delta. Yes, children, right? Is it not surprising? Yes, it is. So other type of water that is solid base is known as glacier. This glacier also creates certain landforms on Earth's surface. Let us have a look. What is a glacier? Slow movement of a mass of ice, that is a river of ice, is called a glacier. The movement of glacier is very slow, unlike water flow. The movement would be a few centimeters a day, or even less or more. Glaciers basically move because of force of gravity. A glacier erodes through a process called plucking, in which it lifts pieces of rock and transports them. These pieces of rock and moving ice together act like a sandpaper on the surface of the rock over which they flow. Just as a sandpaper removes small particles of the wood, the glacier acts as an abrasive and erodes the bedrock. Through this dual process of plucking and abrasion, glaciers created a U-shaped valleys. So this is the mass ice. It is a mass ice which is floating on the mountains. So it is not that much speed as water because it is the huge ice mass. So it moves a very few centimeters a day. It just moves a few centimeters a day. And that movement is also happening because of gravity of the earth. Why it is happening? It is happening because of the gravity of the earth. So when it is moving from the mountains, so the under the beneath of this glacier, it is plucking up. It is plucking up all the pieces of rocks from the mountain and carrying them. That is, it is transporting them into the rivers. So after it melts. So there it is creating the U-shaped valleys. The water creates V-shaped valleys, whereas the glacier creates U-shaped valleys. Okay, children? So as the glacier melts and becomes water, it does not have the force to carry the large rocks which it leaves behind in the form of huge rugged boulders. Some particles and pebbles are left on the bed of the glacier. The glacier brings small pebbles, cobbles, sand, etc. with it. All these debris known as till. The till which cannot be carried by the glacier is deposited around the various parts of the glacier. The deposition of the till is called moraines. Okay, children? So like river, the river is also the same thing. When it is flowing, it is carrying all the particles in with it and it is deposited. When it gets slowed down, just like the river, the glacier is also carrying all the pebbles, cobbles and sand with it, and it is adding all those to the water which is melted, and this water carries all these particles and that is deposited in some other places which is called as till. And the deposition of this till by glacier is known as moraines. Okay, children? So that is with the glacier. So the glacier is forming the U-shaped valley. So moving with the second agent that is changing the earth's surface is wind. It is the first agent itself, water. So water in the form of liquid, it is creating certain landforms. When it is in solid base, that is in ice form, it is creating U-shaped valleys. Whereas we can see one of the form of water, that is waves. So the waves in the oceans or sea creates certain landforms like cape, bays, stacks, sea arches, sand, sea cliff, etc. So how these landmasses, that is how these landmasses has been created at the sea or the ocean by waves. Let us have a look. The erosion and deposition by the sea waves gives rise to coastal landforms. As the sea waves continuously strike at the rocks, cracks develop in them over time. Gradually, hollow caves are formed on the rocks. As these cavities become bigger and bigger, only the roof of the caves remain and form sea arches. So this is the sea arches. Further erosion breaks the roof. Only walls are left. Only the walls are left. These walls like features are called stacks. So this is called as stacks. The steep rocky coast rising almost vertically above a sea water is called sea cliff. Okay, children, what is happening at the oceans and the seas? So here the landmass is cut away by the waves. So these waves is coming with a force, with a great force, where it is splashing the rocks with a great force. So after so many splashes, that is splashes, the rocks becomes weak and gets some cracks in between them, and this cracks becomes bigger and bigger. So it is going to change bigger and bigger. Later, after a long time, that is after a long period, after so many splashes of the waves, this becomes like this. This caves becomes like a arc. Later, after so many splashes of waves, this arc becomes a stack. Later, due to the continuous process, this becomes as a sea cliff. Okay, children, the waves creating the sea arches, stacks, and also the sea cliffs. Not only these landforms, the waves also creating the two major landforms, that is cape and bay. So what is the difference between cape and bay? When a landmass cutting into the sea or the ocean is known as cape. On the other side, when the water comes into the landform is known as a bay. So our country India is the landform which is the best example, which is having these type of features, that is bay as well as cape. So this is the landmass, which is obviously we called as peninsula, which is cutting out into the sea. So this we called as the cape. Whereas this portion, the water is coming into the landmass, came into the landmass. So this portion is known as a bay. That's why it is called as Bay of Bengal. Right, children? And not only this, the seashores or the beaches you find near the seas or oceans, it is created by the waves itself. So the waves carry sands, pebbles, cobbles, etc. with it, which is deposited on the seabed. So that's why you can see the beaches around the sea or the oceans. So that is the work of water. So the water has created so many land masses. So what are the land masses? The water created, it created V-shaped valleys, gorges, canyons, plung pool, meanders, Oxbow Lake, and in type of glacier, it formed U-shaped valleys in the form of waves. It created an sea arcs, sea cliff stacks, and also the beaches, the bays, and the caves. So moving to the second agent, which has created other landforms on the earth, is wind. So this wind is also have the capability to create certain land masses. So what are they? Let us have a look. So here on the screen you are seeing certain images. here in the desert area, the wind is blowing. And what is this is called? Is that a mushroom? No. It looked like mushroom. That's why it is called as mushroom rocks. So these rocks can be seen in the deserts. Whereas this type of landmass is nothing but Inselberg. So this is also Inselberg in the Nigeria. So how these landmasses has been created by wind? So winds in desert are often extreme and unrestricted by trees and vegetation. Deserts constitute for about 1/5 of the earth's land. They are rocky, stony and sandy. The strong winds acts as an abrasive sandpaper as they carry sand, soil and erode hard rocks. Especially in the desert region, the wind creates many interesting erosion and deposition. So one of the best example we can see mushroom rock. So mushroom rock is also called as rock pedestal or a pedestal rock. These rocks are formed by the process of erosion and weathering. These are named as mushroom rocks since they look like mushroom rocks. These rocks have narrow bottom and wider tops as wind cuts lower section of the rock more than the upper part. So the wind is cutting the lower part more than the upper part. That's why it looks like a mushroom. So next form it is Inselberg. Inselberg is a German word where Insel means island and Berg means mountain. That is island mountain. So here nearby there is no other mountains you find. So it is isolated. It is the single island on this earth surface. That is why it is called as Inselberg. Inselberg represent characteristic rock outcrops which rise suddenly above a plain, hill, country or rainforest. The isolated hills rises equally from the ground are called Inselbergs or island mountains. Yes, children, so with the erosion and weathering, the mushroom rock has been created. So again, with the deposition and weathering, the Inselbergs has been created. So the wind also creates the sand dunes. Yes, sand dunes. If you remind sand dunes, you will always get an image of Rajasthan. Yes, children? Sand dunes means desert and desert means sand dunes. So here, your imagination is true. Sand dunes always exactly looks like this. Okay? So, children used to play on inside very much and you would like it very much, right? Yes? Yes. But it's a very hard to survive in desert areas in sand dunes because it is very hot. You cannot find water. You cannot find a thicky vegetation. You cannot find any food over there. So don't go to deserts. Just play in the sand which is bought for your construction of buildings, etc. Okay? So sand dunes. Sand dunes, 1/4 to 1/3 of the world's deserts are covered with sand. A sand dune is an accumulation of sand formed by the wind, by waves, and by eroding sandstone. The structure constantly changes since they are dependent on the ever constant forces of wind and water. Sand dunes acts as a natural barrier against storms and waves protecting houses and cottage that may be inland. Loess is a geologically recent deposit of silt material, which is usually yellowish or brown in color and consisting of tiny mineral particles brought by the wind to the places where they now lie. They are rich in lime or foam and coherent. Loess plains are plains formed by the deposition of loess. So the sand dunes are created by the wind. So the sand dunes were created by wind, by eroding the sandstones. So you can find the sandstones on the surface of the deserts, and it is eroded, that is, it is weathered, eroded and transformed to one place to another place. Then you can see the sand dunes. So what is loess? Apart from sand dunes, a lightweight particles mainly, which is called as silt, which is usually in yellowish color or in brown in color. They are passed by the winds beyond the deserts. So it is deposited there. So likewise, you can see the sand, beyond the deserts, you can always see a loess areas, that is loess plains or loess hills, etc. So loess is the most fertile land containing with a thick vegetation, which gives scopes for thick vegetation because it is very fertile in nature. So that is about the work of wind. The wind is creating mushroom rocks, inselbergs, and also the sand dunes in the desert, and also it is creating the loess plains or the loess plateaus or the loess hills. So after all these, let us look the action of vegetation and human beings on lithosphere. So the earth's surface, that is crust, is covered with many landforms which may be formed due to the actions of internal process of the earth and also the actions of external process of the earth and also the agents like wind and water. This lithosphere on the earth is also changing due to vegetation and also the human actions. Yes. The plants, trees, and other species on the earth were responsible for creation of certain landmass, and also we, the human beings, are very much responsible for changes in the land masses on lithosphere. So how it is possible? Let us have a look. Action of vegetation and human beings on lithosphere, in simple terms, mean the impact of biosphere on lithosphere. So whatever the flora, fauna that we are seeing on the earth's surface, it is nothing but the biosphere. So always there is a impact of biosphere over lithosphere. So humans are now responsible for causing changes in environment that hurt animals and plant species. Vegetation like trees, plants, grass, etc. help in weathering of rocks. Weathering causes the disintegration of rock on the surface of the earth. Plant and animal life, atmosphere and water are the major causes of weathering. Weathering breaks down and loosens the surface minerals of rock, so they can be transported away by agents of erosion such as water, wind and ice. So this is the image. You can see how rock is weathered by a tree. So children, have you ever noticed some plants are growing on rocks in a hilly region? And sometimes you do notice some plants are cropping up in buildings also, on the surface of the buildings also. Yes? So when the trees grown up on the surface of the rock, it give a scope to weather that rock. What do you mean by weathering? In the earlier class, we come to know that weathering is nothing but contracting and extracting of rock during day and night, during summer and winter, etc. And this process weakens the rock to get cracks and to get weakens. So when the water reacts with the chemicals of the rock, it is separated from the mother rock and carried away by the wind and water and deposited in some other places. So that is all we studied in the earlier class in the process called degradation process, that is weathering, erosion, transportation and deposition. So in the same way, these plants is giving scope to weaken the upper surface of the rock. So when the roots of the plants drive into the rocks, fine cracks, holes are formed on the rocks, which help the water to seep into the rocks. Moreover, the plants and grass layers on the soil help in the prevention of soil erosion. We, the humans, also play a major role in transforming of the crust, like mining, building cities with bricks and cement, agriculture, construction of dams, etc. So the plants are, that is, vegetation has been changing the surface of the lithosphere. At the same time, human actions like mining, building, agriculture, construction of dams is giving a scope to pollute the environment and also which is hurting the plants and animals, etc. So children, how the mining, so before that, what you can see in these pictures? The first picture, it is mining. Secondly, you can notice cement and bricks. Thirdly, it is agriculture. And fourthly, a bridge, that is a dam is constructed. So construction of a dam. How these actions are a cause for changes in lithosphere? Try to get the answers how human actions like mining, buildings, building of cities or houses with bricks and cement, agriculture, and also construction of dams, how these actions are responsible for changes in lithosphere. So try to get the answers. So with that, we have been completed the topic, the natural realms of the earth. So let us have a brief look on the summary of the topic, on the summary of the lesson. That is, in this lesson, we majorly learned the four great realms of the earth, that is lithosphere, hydrosphere, atmosphere and biosphere. And later we discussed about jigsaw puzzle, mainly the plate tectonics. Next it is slow and sudden movements of the earth, that is creation of volcanoes and earthquakes. The external process, that is weathering, erosion, transportation and deposition. And in today's class we discussed about work of water, glaciers, waves, wind and also the action of vegetation and human beings. So here is your homeworks. Depending on the today's topic, so note down all the questions in your notebooks and try to answer them. So with this we completed the lesson. I'm very much happy, feeling very much happy to teach in Suryapet District YouTube channel. It's my pleasure and it's my honor. I'm very much thankful and I'm very much thankful to all the members who has put a lot of efforts to create this YouTube channel. Mainly our DO sir, Sri Madan Mohan Garu, and all the technical team members, the coordinators, all the subjects RPs, who has put a lot of efforts to bring a useful and gainful knowledge to the students in COVID situation. A very heartfelt thanks from the depth of my heart to all the members who helped me to teach through online. Thank you.